the field and become dependable targets for their quarterbacks and move the sticks, those guys are worth their weight in gold.
Here's the former seventh-round pick, Rashad Jennings. 5 yards is the tally on first down. That brings up second and five. This Minnesota defense should be amped after what they did in week three. 8 sacks in that game.
And just the idea of getting Cam Newton on the ground 8 times, that's awfully impressive. And not only that, they held down their big wide receivers, Kelvin Benjamin and Devin Funchess. 0 catches.
That's unbelievable.
For each of them. This is a defense that has the look of a defense that can carry a team a long way.
The tackle made there by Linval Joseph. Big boys down there in the trenches, and a nice play to stop them cold. Nothing there.
Yeah, when you talk about big boys, you're talking about those defensive tackles, those nose tackles. They're not just big, they're immense. And what a big time play there.
And the Vikings are going to beef up their secondary here. 6 DBs on third. From the gun on third down, Manning to Vereen out in the flat. And he's got the first down yardage before being taken down at midfield. It's an 8-yard pickup and leads to a new set of downs.
I feel like Eli Manning has just gone from downfield bomber to a guy who can complete everything.
He can hit him underneath now,
yeah,
can't he?
Yeah, we just saw that there with that pass completion. The maturity of a veteran taken with the defense will give him.
Now it's Jennings. And he's going to be met at the line of scrimmage and taken down. Credit him with a 1-yard gain there to make it 2nd and 9.
A 1-yard gain can look like a disaster, but it all depends on how the game is going. Is it a series of 1-yard gains running the ball? If that's the case, you might have to start thinking about throwing it a little bit more. But if it's just the occasional 1-yard run, hey, congratulations to the defense. They won that one. Come back and get them the next time.
On 2nd down, here's Manning. Throwing over the middle, and it's incomplete. They were trying to get it there to Sterling Shepard, and they're going to face a 3rd down.
NFL quarterbacks work so hard on their mechanics, and they do so much repetition and practice, off-season, the whole deal. They expect it to be autopilot once the game starts. That way it eliminates any type of pressure of the game, pressure of people in your face, all of that. That didn't shine through on that throw, though, did it?
No. A little bit of a dangerous pass and off target, too. And he couldn't hang on to it through the contact. Incomplete.
We know it's not an easy job to go out and catch passes when people are trying to tackle you and knock the ball away. But the bottom line is, that's a pass he's got to have and a pass he should have caught.
On now is Brad Wing to kick it away for the Giants. Marcus Sherrill's back deep for Minnesota. And this will be out of bounds. Now it's a question of where they'll mark it. And they'll say it crosses at the 11-yard line. And out now come the Vikings. Georgia Southern man, this is Jerick McKinnon. And an alley to run, and he's brought down. They'll get 19 yards there, and that leads to a Minnesota first down.
And that run was what a lot of people call an explosive run. Gave them good yardage, solid yardage. They feel good about the whole thing, and they did it behind a 2 tight end set. It's always interesting to watch what offenses want to do with the 2 tight ends. Sometimes they line them up together for a power set. Sometimes they put one on each side of the line of scrimmage to balance things out. No matter what, though, when you see 2 tight ends on the field, your first thought is to think run. In this case, the offense was able to run successfully. And that was a nice play by the defense. And it is tough to be an offensive lineman nowadays, especially if you're dealing with how the defensive tackles have evolved. Their quickness, their agility, their speed has changed the big guys in the middle, the center and the offensive guards. Formerly, they were just power players. Now they have to be light on their feet as well to keep up with the speed of the defensive players.
Oh, a battle for it here, and this will be caught. A nice gain of 21 yards.
Love the call by the offensive coordinator, recognizing the situation very well, calling for the play-action pass, and completing it.
First down and 10 now for the offensive group.
Green, 39.
McKinnon. And it'll be a minimum pickup here as it will take us to the end of the first quarter. Back now with Charles Davis. I'm Brandon Gauden. Second quarter begins with the Vikings holding the football. They've got a second down and 8 to start things out.
Here we go now.
Bradford now from the 50. To the sideline, and oh, a nice catch there. Made sure the feet were inbounds, and they were.
Can you do any more work or make it more dramatic for not much gain than what we just saw there? Did you see how his toes got down? Tip-tap, tip-tap, got him down. But what did he get out of it?
He sold the sizzle. He just had no stake.
I mean, was it 1 yard?
Yeah, you plays like that, you at least expect a first down. There's just 1 yard. Bradford, he's got time, and down he goes. A sack. They sack him back across midfield at about the 48-yard line. And we say it all the time, have to be able to get rid of the ball sooner than that.
You have to help your offensive line out. They're going to protect you as best they can. And if you're getting 3 to 5 seconds to throw the ball, they're doing a really nice job. But when you hold it and give up a sack, you're really almost discrediting their work.
And he gets it away, a directional kick going toward the sideline. That'll be out of bounds, and how good was that? They'll say the 3-yard line, that's where they spot it. Now out come the Giants. And last time out, they had to punt the football away. Anything positive possibly to take from that?
There always is when you're punting the football away. It doesn't sound like it because you're giving it up, but you've avoided a mistake.
At least you didn't turn it over,
I guess. You didn't turn it over, right? You're giving your defense a chance. Because you're punting the ball away, and they're set to go on the field as opposed to sudden change after a turnover. Wow, now we've got to go out there and stop people. So, yeah, there's always something positive to be gained from it.
And the offense there, the O-line, everybody really on offense, they were just manhandled at the point of attack.
Yeah, you could pretty much call them all out, couldn't you? Almost by name, right? That was a very tough sequence for the offensive line. But how about that defensive front creating a new line of scrimmage and creating a lost yardage possibility?
They run again with Jennings. Looking for a seam but finding none. He'll get back to the line of scrimmage, and that's it. They'll lose a yard, and it brings up third.
There's another example of why they haven't scored any points so far. I think it's time to abandon the run game, spread things out, and go to the air. It certainly can't be any worse than what they've done so far.
And the Vikings with an extra defender in the secondary on third.
Playing coverage here.
And he'll maybe get back to the line of scrimmage, but no more than that. And when you're running the football, one thing you don't want to see is a big boy coming up there and swallow you whole in those D tackles and nose tackles.
No, you're actually counting on your big boys to protect you from them. But on that play, the defensive tackle had the leverage, and he won the battle. No gain, correct?
No gain. So a free kick situation forthcoming from the 20 as they'll punt this one away. This is taken at the 18. Now the Minnesota offense set to take over again. They've got the lead. Last time had to punt it, though. What's the key to this drive?
I think it's leverage.
Leverage.
Big guys up front. You know the motivational speech on the sideline is, guys, give us an opportunity. Protect the passer, create space for our runners, and let's go ahead and give these guys. Low man wins. Let's go do it on this drive.
We'll watch that leverage on this drive.
Ace.
And the first play of the drive goes to McKinnon. And he is swallowed up right at the line of scrimmage. No gain on the play there. Second down. So nothing there, but maybe you blame that on the blocking.
Yeah, at some point, you've got to win at the point of attack. And on that play, that was all the defense. They made it happen.
Here we go. Blue 45.
Play action now. Bradford. Now a clash of bodies here, and it's intercepted. Picked off by Dominique Rogers-Cromartie. And his crew will take over at their own 45-yard line. Here's the Giant offense now making their way back out onto the field. And, of course, coming off the safety the last time they had the football. Never won that.
No, that's pretty unique, too, isn't it? When you give up points that way and the scoreboard, you look up and it says 2-0,
It can throw you a little bit. Let's see if they can put that to the side and move forward.
You know, in week three, there were a lot of great plays, diving catches, but certainly the smartest play came from a Stanford man, Ty Montgomery, in the game that you called up at Lambeau.
Of course it'd be a Stanford guy, right? Kickoff return, it bounced in the end zone and then back into the field of play, and he knew he was in trouble right there. So he goes to the sideline, puts his feet out of bounds, and possesses the football because he knew at that point that would mean the kickoff was technically out of bounds and the ball would come out to the 40-yard line for his offense. Very heady play.
Third down and four. Shotgun now for Manning. And incomplete. He had nowhere to throw, so he just tossed it away. But that brings up fourth.
I'm not sure we could spot any tendency here on this third down. They could have run it or passed it. Either one was available. They chose to try and get it through the air, but they run successful.
Here's Brad Wing now as he'll kick it away for the second time. That one sails out of bounds. The side judge will walk it off. And he says it went out of bounds at the 9-yard line. Nice punt. And now out comes Minnesota. And following the interception, we'll see what they can put together on this drive.
I can hear my old college coach right now. He always used to tell us before every game, the team making the fewest mistakes will win. What they're hoping is that that last mistake is their only one of the game.
Coaches, that's all they talk about, turnovers, right?
Minimizing those and maximizing opportunities.
They go back to the air here after the INT on the last drive. And able to get it here to about the 16-yard line. Rudolph was solid in their win at Carolina. 7 catches, 70 yards, and a touchdown.
How about that touchdown catch? I call it a reverse fade route. Outside receiver comes inside. Rudolph flexed out. He ends up going outside and running the fade. Really nice throw by Sam Bradford. An excellent catch by him. But I don't think anyone's happier about the success of Stephon Diggs out wide than Kyle Rudolph, because that's opening up the middle of the field for him, and he's taking full advantage of it.
They get 9 out of that one, and as a result, the drive continues. Now, whistles come in. We're going to get a timeout here by the offense. It's just their first, so they'll have 2 remaining here before we get to halftime. First and 10, Bradford, a dump down to McKinnon. Look at the dance and the juke. And he's able to get this one up to the 45-yard line. It's a gain of 20 that time. And it'll be a Minnesota first down. So after that big gain, let's see what else the offense has up its sleeve.
Green, 90.
Bradford on first down. And all this is taken in one-handed. What a catch. 23 yards on the play.
That was a terrific catch. I mean, to go up there and get it one-handed like that, but I almost want to go into that riff about back in my day, the gloves weren't quite like this.
When did gloves really become prevalent, just in general?
I think in the 80s. I think as we started to move through the 80s, especially as we got towards the latter part of that. But a lot of those were really like baseball batting gloves to begin with not much of a tacky area on the glove. In fact, there was none. I actually remember in cold weather games wearing the old scuba gloves, which you'd wear in the diving, but they would...
Now hold everything here. We're going to get a timeout by the offense. And with halftime on the horizon, they'll be out of timeouts from here forward. So on second down, the field goal unit is on here as they try to get three before half. From the left hash, this from 39. And Walsh able to convert it as his kick is good. And that will give us the very rare scoreline of 5-0. So it's our first offensive points of the game so far, and it gives us a very rare scoreline. We don't see this one often, 5-0.
Yeah, it's been sort of a weird one to this point, hasn't it? But hey, in this league, you take points any way you can get them.
Now after the made field goal, Walsh back out to kick it away. The return man here, Dwayne Harris. Oh, a nifty juke there.
Not much fun for a guy trying to tackle it.
And New York set to take the field. And from this spot in the field with the clock where it's at, you think we're just going to see a knee and that's it?
And I think in this situation, that's the proper play. But we do know there's some risk takers out there that may want to take one more shot before the clock runs out.
And with time running short here, they'll simply take a knee, and that should do it for half number one. So we've reached halftime here in Minnesota with the Vikings on top as we send you down to our EA Sports Studios in Orlando where we find our man Larry Ridley with our halftime report. On the return, here's the dangerous Cordero Patterson. And he'll take it a yard or so past the 20, call it the 21-yard line. Out come the Vikings. They'll have it first on offense as we begin the third. They have the lead. Now they'll be looking for some separation here as we begin the third quarter.
I like the way you term that because now I think they go a little bit deeper into their playbook. They like what they did in the first half. That worked okay. But in order to get the separation that you just talked about, change things up a little bit. Change your tendencies, try and hit them a little bit more with some things they didn't see in the first half.
We'll see if they do just that. And he's going to get this one across the 30-yard line.
And that's a good sign right there as we start the third quarter because in the first half, not much space to run the football. And as we go into the half, we often think to ourselves, all right, what's the adjustment? What do they have to do? You know what a lot of the adjustments are? No adjustments. You know the game plan, been working on it all week. Maybe a little tweak here or there, a little bit better blocking, and now you're establishing the running game.
Here's McKinnon. Give him three on first down. It'll set up a second and 7.
In my book, that's running the ball well, but with intelligence. How about him keeping the clock moving, staying in bounds?
Yeah, even though it's the third quarter, you're thinking ahead, aren't you? This is where your running game can really help you with a lead in the second half.
I agree totally. It's not just end of the half situations that you worry about the clock. It's throughout the game. And with a lead, stay in bounds. Make them fight harder to try and catch you.
And he is going to lose yardage here. It's a loss of 2, now third down. Well, good luck there as a ball carrier. You get handed that football, look up, oh, there's a big D tackle ready to swallow you whole for a loss.
Yeah, you kind of count on your guys to give you at least a little bit of time, a little bit of space to try and maneuver, but not on that one. And when you have a defensive tackle who's that strong, that agile, he's a lot to deal with. Sometimes you have to double him, and sometimes you're not able to block him no matter who's trying.
And he's got the first down yardage before being taken down at midfield.
We always talk about having to read defenses and how complicated that is. Well, this was an excellent read. Read the pressure and got rid of the football before it even got to him for a nice game.
And when they're blitzing like that, running back usually a good spot to go with the football?
Without a doubt, because he's right in your sight line or he's near you. So you're able to just get it to him easily. And once he gets in space, that's usually a good matchup for him.
He's got it complete to Diggs, right side. Touchdown, Vikings! Stephon Diggs, 50 yards! And the Vikings find a way to stretch their lead. Well, they went play action there and set it up nicely for him. I mean, he can flat fly, and they hit him downfield.
And it doesn't take much to create that extra bit of space that a guy of his speed needs. If you go play action, all you want is just a moment where the guy's covering, take their attention somewhere else, and then he's by them. And once he's by them, there's no catching them. As they always like to say, if a receiver's even to a defensive back, that means he's leaving.
Unless that DB is Charles Davis, right?
In that case, he left me a long time ago.
Come on now.
Trust me.
And so we have the touchdown. Now here's Blair Walsh to kick this one away. Bobby Rainey now to return it. And he's up past the 20 to the 22-yard line. Here's the Giants offense now getting set to start the third quarter. They're down in this game. A chance for the offense, though, to put something on the board, get some momentum here in half two.
Try and get things kick-started for them. And you know at the half, they discussed how they were going to get that done. This is where scripting comes into play a lot of the time.
How many plays do you script coming out of the second?
Most of the time in the first half, you're scripting 12 to 16. I think in the second half, you're really scripting more like 8 to 10, kind of a starter or an opener, whatever terminology they use, just something to get you off to a quick start.
Give him 9 on the carry that time, and they're set up with a second and 1.
First play of the drive, let's give credit all around. Excellent blocking. But the guy carrying the ball, he was the finisher. A really nice run.
Offense readies for a second and 1. Now Manning throwing on second down. And he'll be out of bounds just shy of the 40. A very solid gain of 27.
You know as well as I do, it's really important to get Odell Beckham Jr. involved early. And that's the first time that Eli Manning was able to find him, and we're in the second half.
You think he and Eli maybe had some words on the sideline? Hey, let's get on the same page.
Without a doubt, because they know that that kick starts their team. That gets them going, and now they have to do it again and again as we go down the stretch.
So after that big play, let's see if they can catch their defense maybe on their heels. This is Jennings. And he is going to lose yardage here. It's a loss of 2 there, bringing up second down.
And that's another stop for the defense, something we've seen all game long. They've been on fire today. No matter what's called by the offense, they've had an answer for it.
Three receivers to the left, 1 to the right. On second down, here's Manning. And now the ball comes out. Manning lost it.
On plays like this where the ball comes free, it's often unusual for the team that lost it to get it back. Because this is the quarterback. The ball gets away from him. Everyone else is trying to execute what they're supposed to do on offense. They're usually looking in the other direction, downfield, or have moved away from him. In this case, though, a teammate is able to come up with the ball.
On third and long, it's Manning. Hitting Dinnell here, the tight end right side. And he'll get it out a couple yards shy of midfield at the 48. It's a gain of 5, and that's going to bring up a fourth down.
That's certainly playing down and distance very well by the defense, isn't it? Take whatever you want underneath, by all means.
Here's Brad Wing now, as he's on to punt for New York. And we return welcoming you back to Minneapolis. It's the Giants with possession of the football, but needing points as we start quarter number 4. Kicks away as he angles this one for the sideline. And the punt over the side in the air, and the spot will be inside the 35. And now out comes Minnesota. And that last drive, a long drive, but not just that, they had a great air attack going. Do they stick with that?
I would think that they would, because if they were competent enough to do it on the last drive, starting backed up in their own territory, why would you change anything? They've got to be confident about what they're presenting and continue to do so.
Yeah, because the secondary, they really look clueless.
And that was amazing because that drive went and went, no adjustments and no big plays by the defense to knock the ball away. Tremendous coverage there, just did not catch the football and complete the interception. But what do they say all the time? If he had really good hands, he'd be playing offense.
Second down, Bradford again. Sideline throw, it's pass complete. And a nice job there of keeping the toes in bounds.
If you run an out route, it's likely you end up near the sideline. And what did we just see there?
Toe tap.
You got it. The benefits of practice. Toe tapping, foot dragging, picking it up, and making sure it was a catch.
And five in the secondary now for the Giants on third down. There's Bradford finding time and finding Cohen. And he's taken down at the 43, but not before picking up the first.
And that pickup of a first down, that's going to leave a mark because they really needed to stop them there, didn't they?
That's so frustrating. Defensively, you're a play away from getting that football back here down late. Tough.
Now they've got to find a way to create a turnover or takeaway. Otherwise, this one will probably get away from them.
They'll run it now out of the gun. And he is going to lose yardage here. That's going to go as a loss of two, and it'll be second down. The fourth quarter here, they've got the lead. They want to keep it on the ground. That's what they're doing.
Smart football. Keep the clock grinding. Keep it going. But you got to figure now, they're going to see more people stacked up at the line of scrimmage as they try and bleed it out.
They run once more with McCannon. And now nothing but green ahead of him. Touchdown, Vikings! Jarek McCannon, 45 yards. And the Vikings are going to add on to their lead.
Well, without a doubt, all credit's got to go to the runner. Found his way into the end zone, but the defensive guys just not wrapping up well when they try to tackle it.
And that's the thing. You've got to wrap up. A lot of times these days you see guys, they just want to go as hard as they can and throw their body at somebody. That's not old school football, though.
No, old school football is fundamentals. Wrapping up, locking your hands, and trying to get him on the ground.
So we have the touchdown now. Here's Blair Walsh to kick this one away. This will be taken in at the one. And not a bad return here. He gets it out to the 25-yard line. And New York set to take the field. And down on the scoreboard, certainly needing to avoid what happened on the last drive, punting the football.
Sense of urgency has to take over for them here. They know the score. They know the situation. And by the way, the punter no longer exists for their offense. That's how they have to treat this drive.
They need points.
Big time.
Manning now on first down. And incomplete, he dropped it. Maybe a rookie mistake there, second down. Try again on second down. Going left side, and he's got Donnell. And he's able to take this one up to the 35-yard line. It's a 9-yard pickup on the play, and that'll make it third and one.
And there's another completion to the tight end. And let's face it, it is hard to overthrow a 6-foot-6-inch target.
It is indeed. Quarterbacks like their speed guys. They like that huge 6'6 target that they've got in him.
They really do, and it reminds me of what one great tight end told me once. He told his quarterback, just make sure you throw it up there. You know, kind of like put up in the top shelf where the kids can't get it.
He finds Beckham complete. The 21 yards there as they convert on third.
But we're used to seeing the guy that you consider the number one receiver double covered, but how about this guy? He's double covered and finds a way to make the play for a first down.
That's how you increase your Madden rating, right?
No doubt about that at all. And you know something? I think we'll hear about that from him soon.
Manning now on first down. And his throw is incomplete. Complete on first. Let's see what second down has in store. One receiver left, three to the right. Manning again here on second and 10. Over the middle to Beckham. And the stop here will come at the 38-yard line. See if they can convert here on third and three. It's a five receiver set. Three to the left, two to the right. Manning going to try and throw on third down. And he is out of bounds inside the 30. Give him 10 yards on that one, and that'll earn him a fresh set of downs.
And Brandon, from our time in college football, where receivers weren't running the traditional NFL route tree, one thing they did learn: find open areas, find soft spots, and set up and catch the ball. And I think we just saw that there.
Yeah, we saw that indeed, picking up the first. On first down, Manning. It's complete. The tight end, Donnell. And he'll be a couple yards shy of the red zone here at the 22-yard line. And quickly, they get to the line. Now Manning again. Drops it off in the flat to Jennings. And he's brought down. It's a 10-yard pickup, and it moves the chains. On first and 10, here's Manning. Incomplete. He was trying to get it to Rashad Jennings. And it'll be second and 10.
And there's a good opportunity. Just went awry there. A drop pass. I guess that's why they call them running backs and not catching backs.
Second down following the incompletion. Manning will try again on second down. They go screenplay with Jennings. And he couldn't quite get there. Tackled down at the one. It's a 10-yard gain there, and it sets him up now first and goal. And now they're in the hurry up. Manning to throw once more. That's caught at the three. Nothing on that one. It'll be second down. And now for the offense. This is play number 11 here on this drive. Someone moved. Flag is out. That's going to be 5 yards.
And that'll drive coaches crazy. You work all week on dealing with loud crowds, on dealing with motion, and then you have a guy jump.
And a really long drive here, and it goes on and on. Again, they'll throw with Manning, surveying the field. And he just chucked that one out of bounds, out of everyone's reach. Maybe a wise call not to take a sack in this part of the field. It brings up third down. They gotta have six here. It's third and goal. An extra defensive back on the field here for third and goal. Manning now on third and goal. And that is caught. He's got it for a giant touchdown. Their dangerous wide receiver from 6 yards away. And the Giants are able to draw a bit closer.
And yeah, that touchdown counts for their team. But I think it counts more for the fantasy guys, doesn't it?
Yeah, it's just something maybe positive to look at on film. But this one's over, let's be honest.
Yeah, I agree with you totally on that one.
So two scores down, time definitely not an ally, but here comes the onside kick. And this is going to be recovered by the hands team. And that should just about put a capper on this one. The Vikings offense now heading out to take over. They knew they needed a miracle. They had to have that onside kick. They didn't get it.
Well, as we knew, even before they put the toe to the leather on that one, their chances of getting that done, slim and none. And I do believe we saw Slim just leave the door, didn't we?
We did indeed. I think we're down to none.
Here we go now. Green 39. Green 39.
They'll run it now out of the gun. And now the Giants will stop play as they take a timeout defensively. It's just their first. They've got two more to use here in the final stages. And now out comes Minnesota. And they were able to punch it in the end zone last time. They'll be looking to do that again here for the defense. Obviously, they'll be looking to stop them from punching it back in the end zone.
It always is punch counterpunch, isn't it? And which team has the advantage? Well, let's just go back. Last time on offense, they rolled downfield, got into a good rhythm. You can see a little more bounce in and out of the huddle. You can see the sideline really get into the game. So defensively, you're thinking to yourself, how do we take that away from them? How do we get the advantage back? Let's see what they come up with. I think pressure is always the first way to go.
You love pressure.
I love it.
We'll see if they dial it up this drive. Now McKinnon. And nothing doing. He's immediately taken down at the line of scrimmage. Maybe a gain of a yard that time, but yeah, from the spot, actually no gain. So third and long. So now a third and 12 with an extra defender here in the secondary, a nickel look. They run it with McKinnon. And he's going to be met at about the 43. 4 yards on the pickup there, but it's going to take him to fourth down. Here's Jeff Locke now, as he'll punt it away for the second time. And this one will not be returnable as it sails out of bounds. And New York set to take the field. What do you do here down like this in this situation? Do you maybe just pick something out of the playbook you haven't called in a while, or you call it a day?
You can do that, or you pick something that's a staple for you and should work better and try and execute that on the way out the door and maybe get back to base and feel a little bit better as you end a ball game that's been a frustrating one for you.
We'll see if they go back to base. This is Shepard on the catch. And he gets this one just shy of the 40. They'll mark him down at the 39. And they're going to speed things up here. And he'll get up and spike it with 11 seconds remaining. So second and 10 here. Now Manning throwing on second down. He's got time in the pocket. Now a desperation throw deep downfield. And that is incomplete. 2 seconds left on the clock.
And when all else fails as a defender, when you're not there in the coverage, your best friend is exactly what we saw there. A big play shot taken by the offense. Unfortunately, it ended in a big drop.
And barring something unforeseen, this will be the last play of the game. One receiver left, three to the right. One final try now for Manning. He's going to let it fly. And this is intercepted, and that should do it. Picked off by Captain Mutterlin, and that will write a finish to this ball game.